If you're our guest, thanks for being here at Fusion Christian Church, and thanks for watching online or at home, wherever you're at. And we are looking today at our series called The Dinner Table. How many of you had dinner this week? Yeah. Right. Some of you did not. I don't know why. I'm on a 3-meal-a-day diet with snacks in between. That's my MO. I like to do that. And I want to ask you a question today as we think about the dinner table. Who are you bringing to the table? Who are you bringing to the table? I am not the type of person, I know some people are like this, they like to eat alone. I don't like to eat alone. I like to be with people. I like people, contrary to some of you might think. I actually like people. Turn to your neighbor and say, he likes people. Yes, I do like people, and I was thinking about the dinner table today, and I had quite the event happen this week. My kids, I can't even say it out loud, brought home a cat. And some of you might have seen this on my wife's Facebook page, but I just wanted to share my pain with you. So if you could just turn your attention to the screen right now. This little clip will play of what happened when the cat came in.
Oh, she's so cute. I'm sorry.
Turn it up.
She's so cute.
She's so tiny. I love her so much. I want her so bad.
Now, that clip goes on for minutes. Minutes and minutes, and what is a dad to do when his daughter is weeping tears of joy because of who she has brought to the table, right? I mean, but I don't know if I can be that mean. I don't know what to do, and we're going to talk a little bit about this. You guys need to give me some help. Give me some pastors and backup here. Now, if that wasn't bad enough, the next morning, I wake up, and I'm thinking to myself, who is ever that excited to see me? No one's ever that excited as they were as excited as that cat. No one's ever been that excited to see me. Has anybody ever been that excited to see you? Like they weeped tears of joy? Like, I'm so cute. You're just so cute. No one's ever done that to me. I wake up the next morning. And I go to get coffee, because real men drink coffee. And I find this cup that says, cats make a lot more sense than men. This is the devil's work. Right? You know, and as funny as that is, I really want to ask us this question today because, you know, we bring all kinds of people home. Last night we had the great opportunity, my wife and I, to host our youth society, and it was a great time. We had fun playing basketball and roasting some s'mores and having candy, which is one of the major food groups, and we had a good time. And, you know, as we think about this series, you know, my kids brought home a cat, right? They brought it to the dinner table. Right, it's not allowed to eat at the table. I'm just letting you know. It's a metaphor, okay? But let's ask ourselves this question. Who do I bring to the table? Who am I bringing to the table? And I'm not just meaning dinner as in like just with food, although that is a huge part of our life. But who am I bringing to the table specifically with Jesus? To that dinner table where that relationship is going to be built. I had a great time this week. Laura and I had an opportunity to go over to a family's house, one of the families from our Connect group. We had dinner. We sat down at the table. You know what we did at the table? Not only did we eat, we got to know each other. The relationship began to be built and things were learned and jokes were made and a good time was had. Who are you? Who am I? Let's make it personal. Everybody say, who am I? Who am I bringing to the table? And I want to talk today in light of that about a man in the Bible. His name was Levi. And Levi was one of the disciples of Jesus. And he was a tax collector. And before we read the passage, we're going to turn there in just a minute. I want to tell you what a tax collector was and what they did. He was a tax collector. And so when we read the story, we're going to see Jesus interact with this tax collector named Levi. A tax collector in that time, in that culture, was completely hated by the Jewish people. Levi was a Jewish tax collector. So other Jews saw him as the enemy, like he worked for the man, because he associated with the Romans, and he collected tax for the Romans and taxed the Jewish people and then gave money to the Romans, which was bad berries because the Romans were Gentiles. And as a Jew, you were not supposed to associate with the Gentiles at all. They were like, they had the plague, right? They had the Zika virus. It was bad. Don't mess with them. And it was so bad, actually, if you read through the New Testament, you will see several times over, it'll say, and tax collectors and other notorious sinners, right? They were grouped together with all these other bad people. Or it'll say, and with the tax collectors and murderers and prostitutes and all other kinds, and people who bring home cats and all other kinds of bad people, all grouped together in that one scenario. And I want you to think about this, because they weren't supposed to associate. In fact, tax collectors were so hated that the Jews made up this like catch-22 to their faith, that it was okay. It wasn't okay to lie, but it was okay to lie to a tax collector. So think about it. Here's a scenario. You're coming into town. You've got your goods. You're going to trade them up. You're going to make some money. You're going, hey, business is going to be good. And here's Levi standing at the booth. Levi comes over. He's got the authority of the Roman officials now because he's an official tax collector. And he says, hey, what you got there? Now, he is able to tax you whatever amount he wants. In fact, it's good business practice for him to tax you as much as he possibly can tax you, because he has to give the Romans a certain amount and the rest he puts in his pocket. So his whole goal is to make as much money from you as he can. That sounds like a fun guy, huh? And that's what a tax collector was. Now, I want you to think about this as we read our passage. I want you to turn your Bibles over to Mark chapter 2. And we're going to see what happens here when Jesus comes into town and he begins to talk to Levi. So Mark chapter 2 tells us the story, and think about what happened and how Levi's life has changed and what goes on. We're going to start in verse 13. And here's what it says. Then Jesus went out to the lake shore again and taught the crowds, and they were coming to him. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at his tax collector's booth. Follow me and be my disciple, Jesus said to him. So Levi got up and followed him. Later, Levi invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as a dinner guest, along with many tax collectors and other, here it is, disreputable sinners and cat people. There were many people of this kind among Jesus' followers. But when the teachers of religious law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the tax collectors and other sinners, they asked the disciples, why does he eat with such scum? Isn't that nice? When Jesus heard this, he told them, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners. Good story, huh? Yes, it's really good stuff. So thinking about that, what is a tax collector? What happened with Jesus? What's going on in the interaction here? Here's our question. Who do I invite to the table? Who do I invite to the dinner table? It's really important. And here's what we can learn from the story. So if we're answering the question, who do I invite to the table? The first thing I need to know and the first thing I should do is, first, I must be going there myself. If I'm going to take anybody to Jesus, I have to first be going there myself. I can't just say, hey, you go right along. I'm going to wait home and watch sports. That's not how it works. You and I have to go there ourselves. I have a friend, his name's Cliff. And we have this ongoing joke that we're going to go fight in the parking lot. And every time, it's a joke, but every time he's like, hey, you want to make something of it? I'm like, yeah, you want to take this? He goes, yeah, let's take this out in the parking lot. I'm like, you want to fight this out in the parking lot? He's like, yeah, let's fight this out in the parking lot. Now, we're totally joking. We've been friends for like 20 years. And at the end of it, I always say to him, I said, all right, you go out there and wait for me and I'll be right out. I never intend to go because I don't intend to get my butt kicked. Right? Now, he would never do that. It's a joke. But Sometimes we're like that with Jesus. We're like, okay, you go right along and I'll see you when I get there. You see, we have to be going there ourselves if we're ever going to bring anybody along with us. That's how it works. You see our story, Mark chapter 2. If you're not going to the dinner table with Jesus, you can't bring anyone with you. Mark 2. Then Jesus went out to the lake shore again and taught the crowds that were coming to him. As he walked along, he saw Levi sitting in his tax collector's booth. Follow me and be my disciple, Jesus said to him. So Levi got up and what? He followed him. He went along with him where Jesus was going. Here's the truth. Jesus wanted Levi to be with Jesus. It's really that simple. Jesus walks along, he sees Levi, he's doing his job, he sees that he's hated by everybody. The only people that really like him are people who are in the same business, or are people who aren't liked anyway by other people. So he's kind of an outcast. And so Jesus comes out and says to Levi, hey Levi, I want you to be with me, come follow me. Now, he couldn't really say to Levi, hey, you go there and wait for me, and maybe one day I'll show up. He says, no, come on, I want you to be with me. I want you to go where I'm going. And if you and I are going to bring people to the dinner table, you and I have to be going there ourselves. Otherwise, we're really not going to make the impact. So Jesus wanted Levi to be with Jesus. The question we ask ourselves is, who do you want to be with Jesus? What friends or what family members or what people in your circle do you want to be with Jesus? It's a really important question. The truth is, as Christians, we should want everybody to be with Jesus. No, not them. I don't want them to be in heaven. They'll ruin the whole thing. I'm going there to relax. I don't need stress out person here to be causing problems. If there's not gossip in heaven, they'll be when they get there. We should want everyone to be with Jesus. Jesus wanted Levi to be with Jesus. If you don't want to be with Jesus, then you really don't want anyone to be with Jesus. And that is the truth. If you and I aren't spending time with Jesus, if we're not making the house of God a priority, if we're not building our relationship with Jesus, if we're not going to the dinner table with Jesus, then the truth is we really don't want anybody to be with Jesus. Isn't that sad? It's really an internal evaluation we need to make. Say, man, do I really love him? Do I really believe the songs we were singing this morning? Because if that's the case, then man, I want, like, hey, you guys all need to come with me right now. Why, where are you going? We're going to Jesus. And you need to come. 1 Corinthians 10 says this, for I'm not seeking my own good, but the good of many. How many? Many. The good of many. So that they may be saved. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. So the question is, who's following your example? You see, it's really, in a very real sense, that every day we're sharing a meal with Jesus. Now, it's not literal food, but we're sharing our life with Jesus. And it comes to this point where we have to decide, am I really going there myself? And if I'm really going there myself, am I just being selfish or am I bringing people with me? You see, Jesus, he could have just passed on by and Levi. I mean, Jesus got this crowd of people. You know, he's got all of his other followers and disciples with him. He had a big entourage walking around with him. He could have just said, oh, there's a tax collector. I don't have time for him. Instead, he said, hey, I like you. Why don't you come with me? I want you to be with me. I want you to come with me. You see, that's the first question we have to ask ourselves. If people are going to come to Jesus through us, through our testimony, am I really going there myself? And I think far too often there's way too many Christians that aren't actually going to dinner with Jesus at all. They're just going through the motions. And once I realize that I want to be with Jesus, I realize that I want everybody to be with Jesus. You see, remember Levi, in this story, it was the churchy people that were upset that Jesus wanted to be with that guy. It was the regular attenders that were already bothered by the fact that he was hanging out with such scum. But Jesus is like, whatever, I want to be with these people. I want everyone to be with Jesus. And once I begin to do that, and I say, hey, I'm going to the table myself, then I invite those outside and I bring backup from inside. Everybody say those outside. And then I bring backup from inside. Say inside.
Inside.
When my kids brought home that cat this week, my wife and I looked at each other. We knew something was up. Something was awry. Fishy. My eyebrow began to twitch. And I said, something's happened. And it doesn't rain in California, so I knew that wasn't it. Because all of a sudden my daughter came down and she started cleaning. And my Jedi senses kicked in and I was like, there's something wrong here. The dark side of the Force is about to come. I'm sensing a disturbance. Right? And my wife and I were sitting there. It was kind of like a late dinner for us. And we were just kind of just hanging out at the little breakfast area we have. And we both look at her and we're like, what's going on? Nothing. I just love you guys. Lies. And in comes the cat. Tears. Waterfalls. Coming. Which is amazing that girls can make themselves cry like that. I mean, it is a supernatural gift from God. You guys should be thanking Jesus. Because it doesn't matter if you're this tall of a little girl, you're just like two, or are you, you know, 72. You guys can cry at will, right? It doesn't matter. Did you see that? And guys are like, what? What happened? Why am I here right now? You know, and that's when we panic. What did I do? Right? My wife and I are looking at each other, and we're both thinking the same thing subliminally. Who's going to be the bad cop? And neither of us wanted to reach for our gun. And so it was like we're desperately crying from within ourselves, back up! Back up! I need backup! Who's going to be backup? We needed somebody to come in to save the day, right? And I thought about this business model, you know, if I could just, you know, in times like this where you could actually just rent a bad parent for half an hour, like you go tell him no. You go tell him I got to get rid of the cat because I can't do it. Right? We need some backup. Everybody say backup.
Backup.
Don't steal my business idea. It might happen. Let's look at our verse. Matthew chapter 2. Later, Levi invited Jesus and his disciples to his home as dinner guests, along with many tax collectors and other disreputable sinners. There were many people of this kind among Jesus' followers. Many. Everybody say many.
Many.
That means a lot in the Greek. There was many of those, right? Here's the truth that you and I need to understand. As we begin to build the church, we're now week number 4 in our 2 services, which I think have been going great. You guys excited about it?
Yeah.
Yes, as you should be. Strategy is the best ministry. Strategy is the best ministry. And Levi was called by Jesus to come out of the life that he was in. That's called grace. And he experienced the grace of God in an instant moment of his life. 1 minute he's just going about his business. All of a sudden Jesus comes by and says to Levi, Levi, I want you to be with me. I want you to be where I am so that where I am, you may be with me also. That's in the Bible. And so he's got this strategy. Next thing you know, Levi says, wow, this guy's going to accept me even though I'm an outcast to the whole society? And Levi begins to instigate a strategy. I want my friends to be with him too. It's a really complicated strategy. Later, Levi throws a potluck and says, I'm going to invite all my other scum friends and we're going to have a scum dinner with the Savior of the world. I mean, think about it for a second. It's crazy. I can't even begin to convey to you how much these people were hated. Hated. And yet here's Jesus. Could somebody pass the salt? It's crazy, isn't it? Strategy is the best ministry. Think about the complete grace of God that Levi experienced. You know, I'm sure that he was a shame to his family. He was an embarrassment to his parents because he was a tax collector for the Roman Empire. He probably hadn't talked to his parents in a long time. They weren't allowed to associate with him anymore. And the only friends that Levi knew was people in the same racket. And all of a sudden, in walks Jesus. And his life is changed forever. Levi experiences the grace of God, and he throws a party. And he doesn't do it on his own. He goes there and strategically invites people that need Jesus too. And he goes to Jesus, he says, "Hey, I'm going to need some backup here. Could you and some of your other disciples come over to the house? Can you tell them what you told me so that their life would be changed too? You see, I invite those outside and I bring backup from inside." That means that Levi took the risk. Everybody say risk. He took the risk. I'm sure it was a huge risk for him to go up to his friends who had known him for years and say, "Hey, I found Jesus." And they're like, "What are you, one of those religious freaks now? Bible thumper? You know the names. You're one of them church goers? You goody-goody now?" I literally was golfing just the other day. I have this thing I do during the week where I golf with people who don't go to church. And every time, "So, Zach, what do you do?" Now, one guy in the group knew. He knew what he knows what I do. And it was a weird, odd time for him to ask me because I had like just shook his hand. Usually you wait till like the fourth hole to tell people what I do because then it messes their game up. Right? Because then they think they got to like be somebody that they're not. They're like, "Oh man, I got to stop swearing and drinking and all this stuff," right? Like it messes them up. It's part of my strategy. So I reach over to grab my club. We're at the first hole. "So Zach, what do you do?" And I look at the guy who he's with who knows what I do. And I said, "Oh boy, here we go." And then he starts laughing and the guy's just looking at me. He's a big, big kind of intimidating guy. And I was like, "Oh man, here we go. Here goes the pastoral judgment. You're one of them, huh? One of those. I know your kind, judging me all the time. Telling me I'm a sinner. Telling me I'm wrong." This is what Levi had to face. And I'm sure he faced this giant risk that he was now going to be an outcast of the outcasts. Literally. "Oh, you're one of those? What kind of freak are you?" But Levi took a very risky risk. And he says, "This is so valuable and so important to me that I'm going to take the risk." Inviting people to the table always involves risk. The question is, are you willing to take the risk? But here's the beautiful part of the story. Levi didn't take the risk alone, and neither should you. This is why you have a church family. This is why you have friends. This is why you have people in your connect group. You know why? So you don't have to take the risk alone. And you can actually go to people who you know need Jesus, and you can create a strategy. What are we going to do? And I am not embarrassed and ashamed to say, "Hey, I'm doing this." Why? Because I want to reach this person for Jesus Christ. I have an ulterior motive. I'm not embarrassed by it. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not scared somebody's going to find out. If they say, "What's your motive?" My motive is that you would come to know Jesus Christ. That's called strategy. Everybody say strategy. He saw the opportunity to change people's lives for eternity. He took the risk. He stuck his neck out. And he invited people to the dinner table. Who are you inviting to the dinner table? Who do you know that needs Jesus? You say, well, I invited them once and they said no. Keep on inviting. Be strategic. Be their friend. Build a relationship. Care for them. Serve them. Do something kind for them. Go out of your way for them. Do what Jesus did. Amen. You don't think Jesus was just accidentally walking by the lake and, oh, hey, what about this guy? Hey, Peter, what about this? Do you know this guy? No. Jesus never did things by accident. He did things on purpose. He purposely went down there so that he could have an encounter with Levi, so that he would change Levi's life, that he would experience the grace of God, and that at that point, Levi would then create a strategic opportunity for his friends to hear the good news of Jesus Christ too. That's called strategy. That's also called a bridge event. That's what we call them here at Fusion Christian Church. We call them bridge events. That we create an opportunity that we can have people come in that don't know Jesus, and that we can introduce them to the Savior of the world. We have a bridge event next Sunday, the church barbecue. We're doing one over here at the park at 1:00 on Sunday after church. I'm gonna be barbecuing a bunch of delicious hot dogs, right? Grade A stuff, right? You know why we're doing that? So we can get together. You know why else? So that you can invite your friends. You see, we don't have churchy functions just for churchy functions. We have churchy functions so that we have a bridge event to bring people to Jesus. That is the strategy. There is no other strategy. That's the strategy. It's not complicated. You know why we have connect groups? We have connect groups not so that you can get together and make somebody else's house a mess. We have connect groups in this church as part of the strategy for a bridge event that you can invite your friends and family to so that they can come to know Jesus. It's all about getting people to know Jesus. That's it. Everything else is an outflow of that. Everything else is a product of that. But that's the strategy. In a few months, next month, we're going to be starting our summer events. You know what our summer event's called? It's called Summer Family Nights. Every Tuesday night at 6:00, we're going to be right over here at Ronald Reagan Sports Park. We're going to have a potluck. We're going to play bocce ball. We're going to wrestle. We're going to play ultimate frisbee. We're going to hang out. We're going to have a good time. That's what people do, have a good time. You know why? It's a bridge event for you to bring people to the table with Jesus. Who are you going to bring? Who are you bringing? Honestly, I think that Christendom, especially in the United States, has become callous to the point that we do not care about the eternal fate of people who don't know Jesus. If they don't know Jesus as their Savior, there is no hope. So there has to come a point where we stop just being friends because I want to be friends, even though that's important, but I'm friends because I care so deeply about this person that I cannot spend my life without telling them about Christ. Come on, church. I have to bring them to the table. And it takes some risk. It's a little scary sometimes. I get the butterflies. I get nervous. I do too. But if I'm going to the dinner table, never go to dinner alone. Amen. Ever. Question is, what bridge event are we using? In Mark 2, it says this, healthy people don't need a doctor, sick people do. This is what Jesus said. I have come to call not those who think they are righteous, but those who know they are sinners. Sick people need a doctor. This is why people say, oh, and if you've done this and you've told me this, I don't remember. So I'm not pointing anybody out. Say, oh yeah, my friend's going to this church, but I told him to come on over to Fusion. Well, they didn't, they're not sure if they want to stay at that church, so I told them to come to our church. You have never heard it from my mouth, and you never will. Please invite people from other churches. If they're in another church, you leave them where they are. You let them plant their roots down and grow deep. There are some great pastors in this city. And I'm friends with a lot of them. Great men of God who are pastoring great ministries that are reaching different groups of people than we are. You leave them where they are. It is not the goal and the mission. Jesus did not ever say in the Bible, go therefore into every other church and find disciples and then bring them over to your church. That's not called growth. That's called transferring. I just transferred that church's problems into our church, right? How many times the pastor would call me, hey, I heard so-and-so is going to your church now. Yeah, that's right. Oh, thank you. Can I buy you lunch? Lord bless you. That's generally how it is, right? And if they're really mean, they won't even call me. They'll just snicker. Just wait and see. It's coming. Now, I know some of you come from other churches, and that's great. You're welcome here. I understand that sometimes things happen, and God says, hey, this is not the place for you. I get it. I'm not dogging that. I understand that sometimes we need to find a home that's best for our family. I get it. But the call of the church is to sick people, not healthy ones. Sick people are people who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. So stop inviting people from other churches. Okay? You invite your people that don't know Jesus Christ. If people from other churches come and say, hey, I'm just looking for a home, welcome. We welcome them. That's a lot of you sitting here, right? And that's fine. That's great. However, our goal, our mission is to reach people who do not know Jesus. Let's be clear. So I invite those outside and I bring back up for inside, which means that I'm inviting the ones Jesus told me to invite. We had to draw up a cat contract at my house. If the cat was going to stay, the kids had to do certain things. We had a whole long contract. All four kids had to sign it. I'm telling the truth right now. It's not a joke, right? Or they were going to get kicked out along with the cat. And now they have to do what the contract says. This is what a contract does. A contract means you're bound by the words of the contract, right? I've got to do this. When we come to Jesus, we need to do what he's asked us to do. Matthew 28. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I love that in the story with Levi that Jesus stood his ground. When the Pharisees questioned him, what are you doing? This is not the churchy thing to do. This is not what we do in Jewish world, Jesus. I don't know if you know this. And he's like, no. Sick people need a doctor, not healthy ones. I've come to call those people who know they are sinners, not the ones who think they are righteous. Right? And he was doing what he was called to do and what he was told to do by God our Father. And you and I need to do what we're called to do and do what he told us to do, and that is to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Your world, wherever that might be, your job, your mom's group, your kid's soccer game, wherever it is, wherever you go on this planet, you're a missionary. And that's what God's called us to do. You see, I invite people to the table with Jesus because Jesus told me to invite people to the table with him. In other words, Jesus wants all your friends to be with Jesus. You see, it's his goal that none should perish. He has no pleasure in the death of the wicked, the Bible says. He wants all men to come to repentance. These are things that the Bible says. See, I invite people to the table for the same reason Levi invited people to the table. Because once you've experienced the grace of the Savior, you want to share it with all your friends. It becomes almost a consuming fire within you that we have to go out into the world and tell people, I got to tell you about somebody. I got to tell you about Jesus. Who are you inviting to the dinner table? You know, I've had several opportunities this week just to shine into people's lives. And every time, you know, you have this thing like, what are you going to say? How's it going to come about? How are you going to word it? What are you going to do? And every time in my heart, I say, Lord, I just take a quick minute and I say, Lord, help me to be an example here. give me the words to say so that I might reach them for you, that I might honor you, God, and I might glorify you in this instance right here. And I'm telling you, every time I've prayed that, not in those exact words every time, it's not a mantra, it's a prayer out of my heart, whatever it is, God's answered me. And God will answer you too. When you decide to go to the table with Jesus, and you decide, I want to bring this person with me because I'm doing what Jesus told me to do, God will always answer your need. That's why the Bible also tells us when you stand before people, don't worry about what you're going to say. Because at that moment, the Holy Spirit will give you the words to say. The Holy Spirit will give you the actions to do and the heart to do it. But first, I have to be going to the table myself. Will you stand with me? You know, Levi, after he came to know Jesus, became one of the greatest disciples, one of the greatest followers of Christ. It was at that point that his life was changed forever, that he became a follower of Jesus. It was at that point that he decided, not only am I going to be a follower of Jesus, I'm going to be a missionary of Jesus, like we saw in Peru, reaching people for the world, in the world for Jesus Christ. So the question I have for you today is, are you following Jesus? Where are you at in your relationship? Are you just one of the Pharisees that's just, you're religious? Or being religious? Or are you going to the dinner table with Jesus? Whether you're here or whether you're watching at home right now, wherever you're at, are you going to the dinner table with Jesus? Where's your relationship with him? Have you let him inside? I'd like you to bow your head and close your eyes, and we're going to pray. If you'd like to give your life to Jesus today, if you'd like to enter into a relationship with him, to become a follower of him, to ask him to forgive you of your sins, to build a friendship with him, then today's the day. The Bible says that all you have to do is believe upon him. He died on the cross, that he rose from the grave, that he paid the penalty of your sin so that you could experience forgiveness. And if that's you, I just want you to slip up your hand. If that's you at home, you're just going to slip up your hand. You're just going to say, hey, I want to do that. And we're going to pray together. Everybody say, dear Jesus, we come to you now. I come to you now. And I give my life to you. I believe that you died on the cross and that you rose from the grave, that you paid for my sin. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and to live in my life. I commit to follow you for the rest of my days. In Jesus' name, amen. Isn't God good? Let's give the Lord a hand.